hope y'all got to that from. Hopefully, all of y'all know that I'm going live now instead of at 3:30, like I said. Anyway, today is December 19, 2019, and the title of the Daily Bread is Written on the Heart. I'll now open up in prayer, and we'll get to the reading. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I praise you, Jesus, for the ability to do the calling that you have put on my life, Lord. I thank you for letting your presence be known in tonight's service at Brighter Day. Dear God, I pray that you, and right now that you empty me out of me and that you fill me up with you, Lord. Dear God, thank you for friends, Lord, especially the right kind of friends, Lord. I thank you, God, for what you've done in my life, and I pray that your presence be known in these videos. May it encourage someone to know you better, to get a little closer to you. Encouragement, Lord, in the tough situation that they may be in. God, I thank you for what you've done in my life, and I thank you for what you've done in my family's lives, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. December 19th, 2019. Again, the title of the Daily Bread is Written on the Heart. You yourselves are a letter written on our hearts, known and read by everyone. 2 Corinthians 3:2. And once again, read 2 Corinthians 2:17 through chapter 3, verse 6. And I let me pause right there. I have to say that I do not have no rights to the music in the background whatsoever, so Facebook does not mute my video. But anyway, it wants me to read 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 17 through chapter 3, verse 6. And it says, "For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God, but as of sincerity, but as of God, in the sight of God, speak we in Christ. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? Ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but fleshy tables of the heart. And such trust have we through Christ to Godward, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life." Now I'll read the Daily Bread, and it says, "As our students write letters of recommendation for them, for leadership positions, study abroad programs, graduate schools, and even jobs. In each letter, I have a chance to praise the student's character, and qualifications. When Christians traveled in the ancient world, they often carried with them similar letters of commendation. From their churches, such a letter assured that the traveling brother or sister would be welcomed hospitably. A letter of recommendation when he spoke to the church in Corinth, to him, to that church, Paul wrote that he preached the gospel out of sincerity, not for personal gain. And once we refer back to 2 Corinthians 2:17, and it says, "For we are not as throughout the word of God, but as of sincerity of God, speak we." And now the Daily Bread goes on to say, "But then he wondered if his readers were defending his motives. He was trying to write a letter of recommendation for himself. He didn't need such a letter," he said. everyone in the church in Corinth were themselves like letters of recommendation. The visible work of Christ in their lives was like a letter, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. 2 Corinthians 3:3 back to, and it says, "For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart." Now they, the brethren, continues to say their lives testified to the true gospel Paul had preached to them. Their lives were letters of reference that could be known and read by everyone. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2. And once we refer back to it, it says, "Ye are our epistle, written in our hearts, known and read of all men." As we follow Jesus, this becomes true of us too. Our lives tell the story of the goodness of the gospel. Now there's some questions. And the first question is, when people read the letter of your life, what do they see of Jesus? Honestly, I would hope that, you know, when people read the letter of your life, you know, what do they see of Jesus? I would hope that in each one of his children that, you know, people see the light of God and the love of God. You know, we should be loved. You know, we shouldn't walk around with a grumpy face on our face all the time. You know, we shouldn't, you know, be rude and belligerent to other people. You know, we should carry ourselves. We should carry ourselves as, you know. So hopefully, to answer the question one for all of us, when people read the letter of your life, what do they see of Jesus? I would hope that we would all show Jesus' love and light through us to others. And the second question is, to have left this imprint on you. That could be anybody. You know, it could be a preacher, it could be your wife, it could be your son, you know, it could be your son or daughter, it could be your mother or father, it could be anyone. I mean, it can really be anybody. Now, there's a part called insight, and I'll read that now. And it says, "Letters of recommendation to introduce and give approval or authority to someone more common in the ancient world. For yourself, you can see Ezra 7, 11 through 26, 7 through 8, Acts 8, Romans 16, 1 through 2, 1 Corinthians, Colossians 4, 10, Since Paul didn't have any such letters, his opponents said he wasn't a true apostle, arguing that he didn't need any introductory or authorization letter from anyone. Paul said that the Corinthians themselves, as believers in Christ, eloquently proved and authenticated his status as an apostle. Chapter 3, verse 3, 1-2, and it says, "Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we as others epistles of commendation, or letters of commendation from you? Epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men, for as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart." I made this point earlier. Am I not an apostle? I've seen Jesus with my own eyes. Isn't it because of my work that you belong to the Lord? Even if others think I am not an apostle, I certainly am to you. You yourselves are proof that I am the Lord's apostle. Verses 1 through 2. And it says, Am I not an apostle? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are not ye my workmen, Lord? If I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you. For the seal of my apostleship are ye in the Lord. Now I'll go to our daily reading plan called Stand Strong. And it is day 7 of that plan. And it is called Simplify. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, like I've been saying in recent videos. You know, the Bible says do not worry about tomorrow because tomorrow has enough trouble of its own. And tomorrow will worry. And the proof is in, and it says, therefore, from the Bible, and it says, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And it's from Matthew 6:34. And in the Bible, Matthew 6:34, and it says exactly what I just read. Therefore, no thought tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. And now I'll go on to read our daily reading plan. And basketball season is not in a crucial situation. The reporter asked how he was able to be so calm in such pressure-packed moments. His answer was that he tried to simplify the situation. You only had to take one shot, he replied. One shot, that is the essence of simplifying. Focus only on what is in front of you. Recognizing that the challenges of life can be both overwhelming and suffocating, Jesus urged us to uncomplicate things. He said, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Again, that is Matthew chapter 6, verse 34. Worry doesn't accomplish anything. Worry doesn't accomplish anything positive. It just adds to the sense that we are drowning in our troubles. We must take things as they come, one day at a time, and trust Him, the Lord, for the wisdom to respond properly. If you feel overwhelmed by life, do what you can and then entrust the rest to Him. Simplify, as Jesus said, each day has enough trouble of its own. Again, for some odd reason, I feel like I should read this again. I don't think wording of Matthew 6. Again, Matthew 6:34 says, therefore, don't worry about itself. It has enough trouble of its own. Amen. I'll go back to and I'll do 5 through 4. Yeah, that's surprising, but that's the whole chapter, that's the whole book. But Bible of the Year, John 1:4. And it says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for the wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord, and went down to Joppa. And he found a ship going to Tarshish, So he prayed the third thereof, and went down into it, to go with him unto Tarshish, from the presence of the Lord. Then out a great wind into the sea. There was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken. Then the mariners were afraid, and cried every man unto his God, and that were in the ship unto the lightness of them. But Jonah was gone down into the sides of the ship, and he lay and was fast asleep. So the shipmaster came to him and said unto him, What meanest thou, O sleeper? Arise, call upon thy God, and so be that God will think upon us, that we perish not. And they said every one to his fellow, Come, and let us cast lots, that we may know for whose cause this evil is upon us. So they cast lots, and the lot fell upon Jonah. Then said they unto him, Tell us, we pray, this evil is upon us. What is thine occupation? What is thy country, and of what people art thou? And he said unto them, I am an Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, which hath made the sea and the dry land. Then were the men exceedingly afraid, and said unto him, Why hast thou done this? For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord, because he had told them. Then said they unto him, What shall we do unto thee, that the sea may be calm unto us? For the sea rocked and was tempestuous. And he said unto them, Take me up and cast me forth into the sea. So shall the sea be calm unto you. For I know that for my sake this great tempest is upon you. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to bring it to the land, but they could not, for the sea rocked and was tempestuous against them. Therefore they cried unto the Lord and said, We beseech thee, O Lord, we beseech thee. Let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not upon our hands in blood. For thou, O Lord, hast done as it pleased thee. So they took up Jonah and cast him forth into the sea, and the sea ceased from her raging. And then the man feared the Lord exceedingly, and offered a sacrifice. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Jonah chapter 2. Jonah chapter 2. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly, and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell heardest my voice. For thou hast cast me into the deep, in the midst of the seas, and the wave passed over me. Then I said, I am cast out of thy sight, yet I will look again toward thy holy temple. The waters compassed me about even to the soul. The depth closed me round about. The weeds were wrapped up about my head. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bar brought me forever. Yet hast thou brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God. My soul fainted within me. I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came in unto thee, into thine holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and vomited Jonah upon the dry land. Jonah chapter 3. And the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the second time, saying, Arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. So Jonah arose and went unto Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceeding great city of 3 days' journey. And Jonah began to enter into the city a day's journey, and he cried and said, Yet 40 years shall be overthrown. to the people of Nineveh and proclaim their fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them. For word came unto the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid his and covered him with sackcloth and sat in ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything, let them not feed nor drink water. And let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily unto God. Yea, let them turn every one from his evil way and from the violence that is in their hands. You can tell if God will return and repent and turn away from his fierce anger, that we perish not. And God saw their works, that they turned from their evil way. And God repented of the evil that he had said that he would do unto them, and he did it not. Jonah chapter 4. Jonah chapter 4. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was very angry. And he prayed unto the Lord, said, I pray thee, O Lord, when I was dead in my country. Therefore I flew unto Tarsus, for I knew that thou art a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness, and repentest thee of the evil. Therefore now, O Lord, take, I beseech thee, my life from me. Hide from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And said the Lord, doest thou well to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city, and there made him a booth and sat under it in the shadow, so he might see what would become of the city. And the Lord God prepared a gourd and up over Jonah, that it might be a shadow over his head. Exceeding glad of the gourd, but God prepared a worm when the wind rose the next day, and it smote the gourd that it withered. And it came to pass, when the sun did arise, that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat upon the head that he fainted, and wished in himself to die, and said, it is better for me to die than to live. And God said to Jonah, doesn't thou well to be angry for the gourd? And he said, I do well to be angry, even unto death. Then said the Lord, thou hast had pity on the gourd, for the thou hast not labored, madest it grow, came up in the night and perished in a night. And should I not spare them, but that great city, wherein are more than 64,000 persons that cannot discern between their right hand and their left hand, and also much power. Now it wants me to read Revelation chapter 10. Hey, Drew. Revelation chapter 10 says, and I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud upon his head. His face was as his pillars of fire. He had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot on the earth, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roared. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. And the angel which I saw stand upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that there and that therein are, and the earth, and the things that are therein are, seeing and the things which are there, that there should be time no longer. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, fear of God should be finished. Prophets. I heard you having spake unto me again and said, Go and take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel, which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, Give me the little book, and he said unto me, Take it, and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey. And as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter. And he said unto me, Thou must prophesy again before many people, and nations, and tongues, and kings. That is the end of the reading for tonight. I'll say a closing prayer and tomorrow. Tomorrow is Friday. I don't believe we have any plans. So I'll be on here again tomorrow night to read the daily bread and the scripture reading to go along with it. I'll be on here at 7:30. I think I'm going to change the time though. I think I'm going to start doing it maybe 10:30, 11 o'clock every night. Because it's kind of confusing. Me changing times all the time. So I may change it to 10:30 or 11. Be in prayer and let me know. If you want to, y'all can put some little bit of input into it if you want. But I think I'm going to change the time. I'm not sure. But as far as I know right now, I'll be on tomorrow night at 8 p.m. And I'll let each and every one of y'all know if the time has changed. I'll do another update. So be looking for it. If there is not one that you see, I will be on at 7:30. So now I'll say a closing prayer, and I'll end the video. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you again for the ability to do what you have called me to do. God, I pray that something that I said tonight might have encouraged someone, maybe even led them to you. God, I pray that you know that you will continue to use me to be the vessel for you that you want me to be. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you watch over each and every one of us tonight as we sleep. Put a hedge of protection around us. Let us wake up tomorrow morning feeling blessed and praising with praise on our lips for you. And let us all know, Lord, that each day that you give us is a blessing. We're not promised the next 10 seconds, let alone the next day. God, I pray that each one of us remembers that we should not worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself, and there is enough evil therein, that we should not worry about it. God, let us just remember, when our back is up against that wall, that we need to praise your name and thank you that you are with us, Lord, and that you see us through it. You never promised that things wouldn't get difficult, but you did promise us that you would forsake us. And let us know, Lord, that the battle is not ours, but the battle belongs to you. You have already won, and you've already overtaken that situation, Lord. God, I thank you for what you've done in my life. Thank you for letting me celebrate 5 months of recovery from drugs and alcohol. Lord, I pray that is maybe addicted. Let them know that the things of this world is not going to fill that void that you're trying to fill. But only you can do that. Dear God, again, I thank you for what you've done. Again, I ask that whatever was said tonight, Lord, I pray that it was an encouraging word to someone, maybe even led someone to you. All this in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Facebook. Love y'all. See you tomorrow at 7:30. Remember, looking for the post. I'll be looking for it. If there is not one as of right now, I know that I will be live on here at 7:30 tomorrow night. Again, I've changed the time to 10:30 or 11. I gotta be praying about that, see what the Lord wants to do. But anyway, good night, Facebook. I love you all. God bless.